God, we love you, and again, we thank you for the gift of this day. Lord, we ask for your help as we steward this day in a way that would bring you glory. We just ask, Father, that you would guide us, that you would strengthen us, that you would let our spirits and our attitudes be encouraged today. Lord, I just pray that as we wind down this school year, that you would help us all to finish strong. Lord, just as we want these students to finish strong, help us to do the same. Let our attitudes remain attitudes that lift up one another, encourage one another, and bring glory to you. And let the words of our mouth stay encouraging and life-giving. Lord, and we thank you for a great end to this school year. We love you and thank you for it in your strong name. Amen. All right, today we are finishing up the portion of this teaching on process. So the last few weeks, as we've been talking about finding the Lord's direction for our life, we have been going to Acts 20 and looking at the story of Paul, these few verses that just sort of lay out his words as he was departing or about to depart for Jerusalem. And he said, now compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem. So we learned that God wants to speak to us. Just as God compelled Paul, God is still in the business of compelling or giving us spirit promptings, leading us by the direction of His Spirit. God still desires to do that and is doing that for His people today. Not knowing what will happen to me there. Anytime we step out to follow God's direction, we should not expect that everything is going to be made known to us. Like there will be uncertainty involved literally at every step, right? It is a walk of faith, trusting the Lord and His direction for our life. He will give us direction. He will give us clarity of where we're supposed to go. But our steps will still seem somewhat uncertain. Paul said, I don't know what's going to happen to me there. I'm clear that I'm to go to Jerusalem, but I'm uncertain what will happen there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. So last week we talked about that there is a resistance that we will find, even when we are in the will of God. Like being in the will of God, our resistance in our life isn't a sign that we're out of the will of God. Many times, resistance, struggles that we will have are a sign that we are right in the middle of the will of God. Because if we were not a threat to our enemy, we would not be a target to our enemy. So many times when we are most in the will of God is when we feel the most attack in our life. Paul said, my only aim... However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. So I want you to see that even though there is uncertainty involved in Paul following God's direction, and even though there is this like guaranteed resistance that is coming with him following God's direction for his life, there is this confidence that Paul walks in, even though he knows that there is uncertainty awaiting him, and even though he knows that there is resistance and hardships that are awaiting him, there is still this amazing confidence that Paul walks in. And I think for each of us, that as followers of Christ, we should be able to walk in a confidence. It should be a holy confidence, knowing that our God is who He says He is, and our God will do the things that He said He would do. Confidence is the belief in oneself or what you are capable of, belief in what you can achieve. Now, for believers, we could take that a step beyond, and we could say it's the belief not just really in ourself, but it's the belief in our Creator and in our Savior, and an understanding that because of Him, He makes us capable for any challenge that life will ever throw at us. Confidence is extremely important in life, and it is important for every individual. Right? I love the story of the little boy who saw himself as a great baseball player. Right, and so he saw himself really as the greatest hitter who ever lived, and so he's got his baseball bat and his ball in his hand, and of course he didn't have anyone to play with, so he would throw the ball up and swing, right, and throw the ball up, swing and missed. I'm the greatest hitter in all the world, you know, so he's confident in that, so he throws it up again and swings and misses. I am the greatest hitter in all the world. So he throws it up again, swings and miss, and he changes his approach. He picks the ball up again and says, I'm the greatest pitcher who ever lived, right? There's a confidence, right, that all of us walk in that says, greater is he that is in me, like greater. Greater is He. It doesn't matter your challenge. It doesn't matter the size of our enemy. It doesn't matter how big the obstacle. Greater. Greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. Because of this, we have this incredible confidence that we should be able to walk in. I want to give you a few thoughts about confidence. And I hope that in some way, at least one of these, a couple of these, maybe and help you with where you're at right now on this road of finding God's direction and being confident in the steps that you are taking right now. The first thing I want you to know about confidence is that you can lose your confidence. Even as adults, now we've seen this like with kids and with teenagers, like many that walk in a low self-esteem or with poor self-confidence, right? But this is not just something that kids struggle with. This is something that adults can really struggle with as well. Having this sense of low opinion of yourself or poor self-confidence. And for adults, it's usually because there has been something in life, whether it is a failure that you have had, you tried something and you didn't succeed at it, and because you didn't succeed, you lost confidence to just even step out and try anything again. Maybe it was a broken relationship, and in that broken relationship, you just lost your sense of maybe self-worth or your confidence in who you are. Maybe it was someone else's words that were spoken to you. Whether it is a family member or a peer, and those words hurt you really bad, and as a result of those words that were spoken over you, you lost confidence in your life. Maybe at one time you were extremely confident. You could make a decision and be confident in it. You could walk through life knowing that God had a dream and a plan for your life, but at some point, you lost that. It is possible to lose your confidence. We see this in athletics all the time, right? Like even at the very elite levels, like you can see some of the best players in the world in their particular sports lose their confidence and get in slumps, right? I've been in a golf slump for, well, all my life. I do remember one time I was in playing golf, and it happened to be with my father-in-law and my brother-in-law, which are people that you always want to beat. And I remember standing. I'd been hitting the golf ball extremely well, which is a rare thing. And so you sort of get this inflated sense of ego and think, I'm going to quit ministry and join the PGA Tour, right? And I'm hitting the ball really well. And then we come to this water hole, right? We come to this water hole, and I made a mistake. Like, I know most of you aren't golfers, so this will maybe mean nothing to you, but in golf, like, the golf balls that you use, cost varying amounts of money. Like, some golf balls are very expensive, and some golf balls are very cheap. Like, you found them in the woods, they've been sitting in a puddle of water, they're just no good. So they're maybe worth a penny, and then you've got some golf balls that are worth like $3 a piece or $4 a piece, right? So we come to this hole that has this water that's like for 100 yards in front of us, and I made a silly mistake. I was looking down and I saw I have an expensive golf ball on the ground. I don't want an expensive golf ball on the ground when I'm about to go over this water. So I reach into my bag, which is illegal anyway in golf, but I thought, you know what? They're across the fairway. They're not going to see this. And I put a cheap golf ball down instead of the expensive, put the expensive one in my pocket. You know what I was doing there is I was telling myself there was a chance I was going to hit the water. And do you know what I did? Not only did I hit the water, like when I hit the golf ball, in golf it's called the shanks. You never want to bring this word up when you're on a golf course. It's just like you never want it. Pac Chevy, you know what I'm talking about. I hit this ball and like it went immediately the wrong direction off my club and into the water. Like I'm aiming this away. It took a right angle and went that way and into the water. And I got so upset that I threw another golf ball down. And I literally, it was like if you've ever seen the movie Tin Cup, it was literally like a Tin Cup movie episode where I threw like six or seven golf balls down, all of them in the water. I wanted to throw my clubs in the water, but it literally, I could not go out and play golf for several months without thinking about this. And I felt like for several months I had the shanks. So one thing you will never see of me now, and it's totally mental. When I come to the hardest shots in golf, I make sure I have the most expensive ball down on the ground. Like that's the ball down. Listen what Hebrews said. So don't throw away your confidence. So don't throw away your confidence because it has great reward. For you need endurance in order to do God's will and to receive God's will and so receive what is promised. I think many of us go through seasons where we throw away our confidence. Or we throw away our confidence in God. We throw away our confidence in God's promises for our lives. And when we do, we miss out on so much that God wants to do in us and through us. It is possible to lose your confidence. And maybe you are there today because of one of the reasons that I stated earlier, or because of something else. You have lost your confidence and you have the shanks in life, for goodness sake, right? And life is just in a hard spot for you right now. The good news is this, point number two, you can regain your confidence. Like, you can regain your confidence. I think a classic example of this is Samson in the Bible. He had lost his confidence. That wasn't all he lost, but for all the reasons that we mentioned earlier, like Samson had gone through all of this. Like he had relationship betrayal in his life, right? He had failed his own people. He had failed his God. Now he was being bullied and being made sport of by all the Philistines, and he was chained up, eyes gouged out, hair cut off, and just really being made a joke of. And that's sort of a really drastic picture of what it looks like when we have lost our confidence in life. Maybe not physically, but you know what it is to emotionally feel the way that Samson did physically that day. Like it feels like the entire world is against you. The relationships have been broken by betrayal. You are being made fun of by others. It looks like everyone looks at you with accusation. It feels like you have failed so many people. And it's like, I don't think I could ever be used again. I don't think I could ever do anything meaningful with my life again. And yet I love that verse that tells us that once again, Samson's hair began to grow. If anyone finds what the recipe was for that, let me know. I need that, right? And then it says this, and I think it is so beautiful because Samson cries out to God. And he puts his hands on those pillars and he said, pretty much, God, I know I failed you. But if you could just strengthen me one more time, just one more time, Lord. And then we find that God came down and once again just filled Samson with this spirit for this amazing, amazing task. And he killed more enemies in his death than he did in his life. But I love that line that says, strengthen me one more time. You know, I believe that when we've lost our confidence, when we come to God humbly and say, Lord, just one more time, restore everything that has been stolen through broken relationships, restore everything that has been stolen through mistakes that I've made, through failures that I've had, through the words that others have said to me, restore it one more time, Lord. I believe we serve a God who is in the restoration business. And I believe that God not only wants to, I believe God loves and cherishes the moments when His people will cry out to Him in such a way. I think He cherishes the moments where He comes down and helps His people regain their confidence one more time. Point three, because when it comes down to it, being confident really is an issue of faith. It really is an issue of faith. And I think this is why God takes great pleasure in restoring confidence to His people. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. And I know that when we're in the middle of it, that it's hard to see it this way. It's hard to see our confidence in this light. But really for us as children of God, when we truly stand and believe that God is who He says He is, that God will do what His Word says He would do, and that the promises that He has made are not for everyone else with the exclusion of me, but they include me. Why? Because that is our God, and our God is good, and He has made these promises to you. They are not exclusive to everyone else and bypass you. When we have this faith in our amazing God, we find that confidence truly is restored in our life. Being confident, I believe, really is an issue of faith. And so if you have lost confidence in your life, go back and again, read God's promises. I think it was Kristen who last year passed out for us in a prayer time some of God's great promises for our life. Go back and read those and personalize them to yourself, because those promises are yours in Christ Jesus. And you don't have to walk around this life with your head held low. You don't have to walk around with the shame of what others have spoken over you, because the Creator of this universe has already spoken over you. The Creator of this universe has already designed your plan. So you don't have to walk in the shame of what someone else has said about you. Walk in His plan. Walk in His Word over your life. Walk in what He has already promised and what He has already declared over you. And last, and I love this, confidence is contagious, right? And I just totally stole this from Vince Lombardi, who said, confidence is contagious, but so is lack of confidence. All right. Let's remember this. I think as we head into this last week of school, let's remember this. Confidence is contagious, right? When we walk with confidence, man, what happens? Those around us just walk with a little greater confidence. And when our students here see us walking around with this incredible faith in God, when they see us walking around with this joy in our heart, that is contagious to them. And so, let's just be contagious this last week and a half of school with the confidence that comes only from God. Only a week. I said a week and a half, and some of you look like, oh, it's less than a week. It's less than a week and a half. Don't mean to slight you there. All right, let's pray. God, we love you and we thank you so much that in you, Lord, in you, we draw our confidence. Help us, Lord, to walk in that confidence today. And let us draw our confidence from who you are and what you have spoken over our life. Because as we do, Lord, we know that we can walk in the direction that you have for our life. We love you and we thank you for this in your strong name. Amen. Bless you guys.